Good morning.
Morning.
How you doing? Yeah. God is good?
All the time.
Oh, I agree with all of you. I agree with all of you. Let us pray, shall we? Gracious Almighty Lord, indeed you are so awesome. And Lord, we come in the midst of this Lenten season and so grateful for all the things that you've done for us. And pray that your Holy Spirit would guide us in the ministry that we seek to do within this the territory you've given us, and that we might serve your kingdom, and that your Holy Spirit might guide us this morning through this time of worship, that indeed the distractions, there's so many of them in this world, might be swept away, and our hearts, mind, soul, and strength might be drawn to you this morning as we praise you for what you've done for us through Jesus and for the call you've laid upon our lives. We ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. A lot of good things to talk about, and we'll sing and we'll pray. And how many of you attended that prayer service on Wednesday? Was that fantastic or what? Amen. Thank you for the prayer team. Walked out of here just feeling fantastic. And how many of you noticed the new front to the church? Raise your hands. Amen. I noticed it. They ripped out those bushes that have been there a long time and put in, and Jim Bertram's been working on that for a while, trying to figure out how to get that done, and it just looks fantastic. If you haven't seen it, drive by the front of the church, which I never do, but just to see how that looks. And I think we're going to be singing our opening hymn here in a second, but prior to that, let's stand up and greet one another, welcome someone back to church or a new face. Say hi to our Facebook people, too. Good stuff.
Yes.
Good stuff. Yeah, I've done 3 funerals in the last 10 days. They're so invigorating.
Pure and holy.
Remain standing and join with me in our opening hymn, number 545, The Church's One Foundation. And let's sing verses 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Is one foundation is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is His creation by water and the word.
Good morning. A few announcements today, and one of them is hot off the press. Our Easter flower situation has kind of changed pretty quickly, and unfortunately, we had to order them already. I know in the bulletin and up here it said that you had until tomorrow to put your order in, but the florist is just running very, very short. So we went ahead and ordered our flowers. We'll have beautiful flowers here, and if we can get any extra, the florist is going to let us know, and if we hear that, we'll let you know as soon as possible if you missed your chance to order your Easter flowers. A few other things. The back elevator, I see the stop sign that I put on it this week. It's working. Oh, it's a lift.
Yeah.
It's a lift. the back lift. Do not try to use it. We had it checked out. It is going to be fixed, but it is currently not working. So please follow the stop sign. Do not get on it. Do not pesco. Then Saturday at the YMCA, we're going to have our annual Easter extravaganza.
Woo-hoo.
Woo! And we haven't been able to do this for a few years, so we're super excited, but we really, really need more volunteers. Like I said last week, 200 to 250 kids are going to be there, so we want them to have a good time. You know, we don't want them to show up and think, huh, what's this church doing? So please, please, please sign up today before you leave. We need people to help set up, to help clean up, to run activities. And again, if you run an activity, just show up, have some fun with the kids. You don't have to plan anything. So please, please, please sign up. Today from 3 to 5, the Chaos Youth Ministry students are going to rock and jump. If you have a child or grandchild that would like to do that, you have to bring them at 3 o'clock, sign a waiver, and then pick them back up at 5, please. And then I believe that's all I've got, actually. Yeah, so have a great day. Thanks.
Amen. Hey, that grandkid thing, where'd Danielle go? Oh, she went out the back. Anybody know, can we pick them up at 5 on Monday? We've had all 4 of our boys, and is anybody a licensed psychiatrist in here, by the way? Oh, those grandkids can be a handful. Hey, listen, I was talking to Bob Hyde. He's kind of, we had this carpet replaced, and they just didn't do the right job, and they've been working on that, and that's coming in the future. That's coming, where they're going to come in and redo this, and things happen. They just continue to happen. We're moving into that time of prayer, and we've had some funerals in the church. We've had some loss in this past couple weeks, and I was just telling Mark. I hate to say this, but I mean it, but it maybe doesn't sound right. Man, they're so uplifting to me. They're just so uplifting. Because at the end of the day, most of these funerals that I experience is a celebration of God's faithfulness. You know what I mean? And I'm not suggesting to you that these are easy. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, man, the body of Christ gets together and we celebrate, and we might do it through tears, but it's a celebration of how faithful God is, and that, hallelujah, the journey continues for one of our loved ones and goes where I want to go, right? And so it is so encouraging to me. And part of the thing that is encouraging, at Kevin McCrate's funeral, who was at that? A few of us were there. Mom and Nat. Okay, you guys. The psalm is Psalm 40. This would be a good psalm to read. Read that. It's a great psalm. And in the midst of that psalm, what it talks about is how Jesus, our Savior, our Deliverer, pulls the psalmist out of the miry clay and puts my feet on the rock, on solid ground, rescues me. And in the midst of that psalm, the psalmist recognizes their own humility, their own humbleness in the face of God. If I were to proclaim all of your deeds, I couldn't do it. I wouldn't have enough time. I mean, he understands that where he sits in the vast array of the kingdom of God. And yet, his hope resides in his God reaching down and pulling, give me your hand, and pulling, meow, amen, and say, see, our God's stronger than me. Praise the Lord. And rescue, amen. And you know what? It's so encouraging when we sit and celebrate how God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rescued another one of us. And to say hallelujah to that. When we pray, I hope that you pray with that kind of hope, that kind of sense that whatever our prayers are, He delivers us. God delivers us. So let's move into that time of prayer as Ben leads us in our prayer song.
Prayer hymn for this morning is number 581 in the Blue Hymnal, Lord, whose love through humble service. And let's sing verses 1, 2, and 3.
Let us pray. Gracious Almighty Lord, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you, Lord, indeed for delivering us, for rescuing us from ourselves and from this fallen and broken world. We lift up these personal prayers that we have that revolve around, in many cases, the territory that we kind of walk in, whether they be prayers of celebration and gratitude or whether they be prayers of burdens and struggles that we or our loved ones face, and just pray that you would guide us and those prayers, that your Holy Spirit might be revealed in the midst of that journey. We know that we live in a broken and fallen world. We see the violence that unfolds globally and nationally almost every day in some way, shape, or form. That indeed we live in a world where justice and mercy does not seem to rule. Lord, and we lift up those places that we know about in Ukraine and across the landscape of this nation, Lord, and things that we are aware of, but there are so many other things that we are unaware of, and we just lift this broken world to you and plead for your mercy and grace, that in the midst of this, your Son might be revealed, and that call that we feel to the kingdom of God might be responded to, that folks might say yes to the journey that you offer them, the invitation you lay before them. So we lift these things in prayer, and Lord, as we seek to continue to fulfill your mission and purpose in this community, we pray that you would guide us, guide those who lead in the church, guide those who participate, that we might indeed find ourselves faithful. Hold us accountable, Lord, and straighten our path if need be. Make us pliable to that, we pray. But help us to be unified in speaking the good news, in calling upon disciples in this township we live in. Unify us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So we're going to acknowledge our offering. John, what you said to me in the main lobby, can I share that?
Sure.
I thought that was really cool. As we approach our offering, you know, we continue to kind of do things like we've done the last couple years. At some point in time, we'll probably maybe pass the plates again. I don't know. But our offering baskets are up here. You can put your offering in before service, after service, when you come up for communion, either way, or many of you have found new ways to do that. And as we've talked about, it's the offering's not about money. You know, our vision that we're going to work out here, you know, close the gap, build a bridge, kind of encapsulates this, the fact that it's about all the gifts and graces God gives us and trying to be faithful. And this is a very faithful church. I commend you. John shared with me, he said, I've got this great idea. I'm going to misquote him, but that's okay. I blame him. You can too. He said, you know, this church, I see it, and I don't know if he brought up March Madness, but all the basketball that's being played, I'm a big nut for it. And we're like, you know, many of us, he said this, I didn't. Many of us are kind of in the fourth quarter of our journey. Or maybe I should say many of you. No. And that may be true. That may be true. I would say we have, you know, if you look around, and you'd have to look a little bit in here, but maybe more at our second service as well, you know, we've got some rookies too, you know, that are playing the game. And but, you know, when you come to the end of the game, there's the clock ticking down, and if you're a veteran sitting on the bench, you just kind of wait for that clock to go down. But not this church. This church gets in the game. You know, our veterans who are sitting on the bench, maybe in their fourth quarter, in the fourth quarter, they're out there getting the job done. And I would say that's, I hope I captured that the right way. And let me tell you something. This Easter extravaganza, I called some other churches who've helped us in the past, and they're not ready. And so some of they would come and they'd man a booth or two because we want to make it a collaborative thing, but they're just kind of not there. But you've been there. You've been there checking in and getting in the game. Because if you watch any of the Marsh Madness stuff, some of these young, talented players, they foul out. And we look and go, Bonnie, I need you in there. I need you in there. And players come off the bench and get the job done. And it doesn't matter where you're at. When the call comes, what we ought to say is, here I am. Call me. Right? And you guys do that. And so when we lift up the offering, we're offering our Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. we're offering our Easter extravaganzas, and our Chaos Youth are going to be going and having some fun this afternoon. We're getting more of these kids. You know what that brings? Chaos. It does. To be successful, we have to invite more chaos into the church. But amen, we have influence with these folks in our territory. That's fulfilling the kingdom. So, Mark, pray for what we offer God in this journey, whether it's in the first, second, third, or fourth quarter of our journey.
Let's bow our heads. Lord, thank you for allowing us to come here to worship you, Lord. Each of us have so many gifts, and not just monetary gifts, Lord, but we're able to give a small part of ourselves back to you. Please allow us to do that so you can use those gifts for your purpose, Lord. And as Pastor Dave said, allow us to just answer the call when you call us to be there for you and be there for each other. In Lord Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thank you. You may be seated. The choir's anthem this morning, the choir, you're still on the clock. The choir's anthem this morning is "Created Me a Clean Heart, O God," and the lyrics, I just feel, there's not a lot of them, but it's very powerful to center our focus as we go through this Lent back on where it should be in having God's love guide us. So contemplate that as the choir sings, "Created Me a Clean Heart."
Good morning again. I'll be reading from Luke 16, verses 1 through 14. The parable of the shrewd manager. Jesus told his disciples, "There was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer.' The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses." So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" 900 gallons of olive oil," he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "And how much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat," he replied. He told him, "Take your bill and make it 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly, for the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than they are the people of the light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourself so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whosoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whosoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you've not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you the property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. He said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, but God knows your hearts. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight." Please bless the reading of this word. And this will be my last time, last Sunday, to read. And it's been an honor to do so, I have to tell you. So thank you all.
Amen. Thank you, Mark. We'll call upon you for another month.
All right.
Let us pray. Gracious Almighty Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart be acceptable to Thee, for You are my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So last week we talked about the lost son, the prodigal son, right? The young guy, he kind of takes off and wants to exit the family and lives foolishly, doesn't he? And then he comes to his senses, the text says, and comes back home, and man, his father welcomes him with open arms. Just kind of, it's a great story. Now, prior to that text, you have the story of the lost sheep, right? One strays, and the shepherd goes after the one sheep, leaves the 99 behind. And you have the lost coin, right? The woman is searching for this coin that has been misplaced. Now, one of the things we talked about there is that our human condition is that we get separated from God. Something stands between us and God, and it's not about those people. It's about all of us, right? It happens to all of us. We find ourselves separated or lost or whatever the case may be. There's a gap there, right? And we know, now Jesus in this story at the end kind of talks about some key things. He talks about the integrity of faith, kind of, you know, if you can be trusted. He talks about in this story about the fact that you cannot serve two masters. And indeed, this young son runs off to serve the kingdom of the world and then comes to his senses and speaks to the fact that whatever we do, God sees our hearts. And that's displayed in the father who saw some value in this wayward son, right? But we know that in this separated world, this kingdom of the world, that it kind of illuminates that the world, how does this world operate? Well, it operates based on power. Right, it operates on a different set of standards, on greed, on selfishness, the love of money, the love of fame, the love of self. We see this all over the place. You don't have to look too far. And that the kingdom of God operates differently. So that's really what we're talking about. Now we're looking at this text in chapter 16, the shrewd manager. What you discover is there are certain biblical stories or texts that aren't often talked about. This one is talked about, but not often, because it appears to me like Jesus is applauding the manager as he continues to cheat the master. Doesn't it? Doesn't it make you scratch your head? What the heck? You know, what is he talking about? Now, I don't think that's what he's doing. But let's take a look at this text. As you begin, let me see if I can find it in my notes. I got lots of notes. Jesus told his disciples there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer." So in the story, we have three characters, right? We have the master, we have the manager, and we have the accusers. The accusers are offset, but somebody's making an accusation, you know, and we'll call them the community. They make an accusation, and clearly the master believes whatever accusations they're making. If the master were also a cheat, they probably wouldn't be telling the master about the manager who's cheating them. Now, in the story that Mark read for us, what happens? The master confronts the manager, and essentially he's firing him. He's terminating him. Now, he probably would have been a great landowner, and the manager, you know, managed all of these different things, and there were clients out there who rented land from the master and had to pay X amount of barrels of olive oil and X amount of grain and so on and so forth. But as he's firing this dude, you know, and he's telling him, "Hey, this is what I've heard, man. You're going to have to turn in the books." Exactly. Silence. Silence. And in this Middle Eastern culture back yonder, silence meant guilt. Now, you could do a number of things. You could explain yourself. You could make some excuses. You could throw yourself essentially on the mercy of the court. The manager does none of them. The master gives him an opportunity. "Listen, you're losing your job." Nothing. Now, this guy's a smart cookie. He can dance, man, can't he? He is fast on his feet. And he's thinking, "Uh-oh, what am I going to do now? I'm pretty worthless out there. You know, nobody's going to help me." And of course, the master has already said, "Give me the books." So he's had one opportunity. Now he's going to have another opportunity to come back and present the books to the master. And what does he do? The manager is, he's thinking, "You know what? I'm a smart guy. I'm shrewd, according to the text. I'm going to go back and say, 'Cut your bill in half. Now sign that, Alan, for me, would you please?'" So in Alan's writing, that's the agreement. He probably winks at him. "Uh-huh, yeah. You're pretty happy today, aren't you, Alan?" Alan's going, "I like that manager." Now, all of this is illegal, by the way, because the guy's been terminated. You know, I don't think his ploy works, but it's pretty smart nonetheless. He has resources available to him. This is what Jesus says. He has resources available to him, and what's he do? He uses them. Jesus says to us, you people ought to do the same. You've got resources. Use them. You've got a fantastic parking lot that can reach the whole community. What are you doing sitting on it? Putting cameras and gates up and not letting people in. Use it. You've got folks who've played the game a long time. Yeah, maybe they're in the fourth quarter. It don't matter. Talk to John. Use those folks. Invite them to get in the game. Take every advantage you can to reach people. Now, the manager, though, his gig is pretty selfish. He thinks he's going to pull this off. But then he's got to go back and give the books to the master. Now, in this story, you know, I've shared with you that Jesus is attempting to speak to a couple key issues. And that one is integrity, right? One of them is integrity. One of them is you can't serve two masters. The other is God knows your heart, but I think there's a different story being communicated here as well. When you look at chapter 16, you must look at this story through the eyes of both chapters. Now, way back yonder, there was this one big biblical text. And what did people like me and monks, what did they do with it? Well, they put numbers in there. Chapter 1, chapter 2, right? We broke it up the way we thought maybe it ought to be broken up. You know, that may be good, that may be bad, you know, because there are separations that you have in throughout the entire biblical text. But here, you break up this story of the prodigal son and the extravagant father who welcomes his son in, open arms, right? Forgives him of completely wasting the resources of his inheritance. The older brother's kind of ticked off about all of this, isn't he? Right? This is the story. The dad is too extravagant with his grace and mercy. Who would like to serve that God? Right? The young son, though, is held accountable. He repents, doesn't he? I have sinned against you and heaven. But see, here in this story, the master is the same person as the extravagant father. The same exact person, except a little bit different. We see a different side. The master is holding the manager accountable, isn't he? But I think he's giving him two opportunities to repent. The first one, come on in. I've heard the accusations laid upon you, and you're going to lose your job. That's a tough road to own it, isn't it? And he misses it. But then he has another opportunity. The master holds this manager accountable. Now, what does this say about God? One, you know what? God knows your heart. If you sense in any way, shape, or form you're getting called into the office, what should you do? Oh, Lord, get on your knees. You know, that might be hard for your pride. Amen? That might be a hard gig to handle, to humble ourselves. But let me tell you something. Here's the thing. You will receive grace and mercy. That's part of this story. God does hold us accountable, and he knows. You might think that you can play some kind of a shell game and fool God, but the moral of this story is you cannot. So in any way, shape, or form, if you're coming to the Lord and realize that maybe you need to repent, what should you do? Repent. You know, but the other kicker is that, man, you get welcome like you're the lost son. Let me take off the signet ring. Let's have a big party. The extravagant nature of God's love. Amen, Bridget, because that's how you're viewed. In the prodigal story, the eldest son looked at his younger brother. What did he see? He saw a loser, didn't he? He saw a worthless loser that squandered the good grace of his father. Really kind of wondering, what in the heck are you forgiving that dude for? He's no better than a snake. Maybe the snake you saw in the Garden of Eden, right? Crawling along on his belly like a worm. Crawling through all kinds of filthy stuff and eating who knows what. What kind of filth? The same thing that pigs eat, that boy ate. That's what the eldest son saw. He saw a worm, a snake, but the prodigal father, the extravagant dad, didn't see that. He saw the best in that boy, didn't he? He saw a young man that came to his senses. He saw somebody that was more than something crawling along the ground or a young kid stuck in a pig's sty. Eating the same squander as the pigs do. He saw a butterfly, right? He didn't see that worm crawling on the ground. He saw a young man who might soar, who might fly among the flowers, who might bring joy and grace. The eldest son just saw a worm, right? We often look at one another through the lens of the eldest son, right? We don't see the best oftentimes in one another. We see the worst. We seem to sometimes need to judge each other, but I don't think that's the lens God looks through. He sees us in a different way. He sees the absolute most that Bonnie brings to the table. And really, his strategy is how do I squeeze that out of her? It might mean that she gets on her knees. That's hard, isn't it? But at the end of the day, we serve a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that sees the very best in you. Will he hold us accountable? Yes. Will he call us to fall on our knees? I think he will. I think the master, I wonder what he saw in the manager. Did he see a man that if he would have repented, if he would have said, you know what, I'm owning this. Did he see something that no one else would see? And the story might turn right on its head if the manager just would have taken the bait that the master gave him. So in the midst of this story, it does talk about what separates us from God and that there is accountability. But remember, we are welcomed by a God who sees the most, to seize the potential in each of us, who sees not snakes, not worms, not caterpillars, but sees butterflies. And I don't know about you, but it makes me feel awfully good when God looks at me and I think he sees the best in me. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you that in the midst of this journey, as many of my brothers and sisters were hanging you on a cross, and they treated you like you ought not to be treated, you nonetheless looked at them. You didn't see the worst because you asked your Father in heaven to forgive those very people of what they were about to do, just like you forgive me, because I think you see the best in me. I pray, Lord, that we strive to allow your pruning in the midst of our journey, that we might become that which you know each one of us has inside of us, that we might continue to serve you faithfully. We ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we're going to have communion. I'm not sure if we'll get back to the cups where we dip in the cup. We'll take it one day at a time, I think, even though the numbers out there are very minimal. So we'll continue to invite you to come forward, and we'll have a couple servers here, and we'll tear a piece of the bread off, and just hold your hand open, and we'll place it in your hand, and then we'll put some of these prepackaged communion items on the table, as well as the cups. You can take whichever one you want. The cup, of course, will be easier. The prepackaged, you got to peel the top off it, and then you can head back down. So we're going to do that and invite you to participate in communion. I'm going to ask Mark and Deidre's going to help, and I think Sandy's going to help to kind of go make sure you use that hand sanitizer as we prepare. And I know that Kimberly has been taking, we've got some new trays for the kids. I'm going to put this, Kimberly, right on the pew, and you can take that down to serve our kids downstairs so they can partake of communion. Jesus, you know, they're kind of having a party. They think it's a party. The disciples think it's a party. They're not quite aware of what's going to unfold. But they can look back on it and realize how they, through this moment in this, what we call the Last Supper, how they're rescued. And where Jesus says they're having for some of the gospel, a Passover meal, and he takes a loaf of bread, give thanks to his Father in heaven, and then invites his disciples and take and eat, for this is his body broken for each of them. He takes a cup of wine and would have given thanks to his Father when he lifted both the bread and the cup, and then declares to his disciples that this is his blood shed for many for the forgiveness of their sins, and to drink of it. And remember me, he says. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you. We just thank you for your willingness to humble yourself for our sake. Lord, and we ask that your Holy Spirit might descend upon these elements of bread and cup, not only those that are here, but those that are in homes participating with us right now, that through your Holy Spirit, these elements might become your body and blood. It's a mystery to us. But as we partake of these elements, we may become your body and blood. Your Holy Spirit might shine brightly in us, Jesus, until you come again in all of your glory. We ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the table's been prepared, and you are invited to partake of these elements. So receive the invitation.
Would you please stand and join me for our closing hymn today? And before we sing, I'd like to introduce, a little late in the game for me, but Kathy Reichenberger is coming, who's playing organ for us today instead of Christina. So if you guys could come up and say hello to her. Yeah, say again. Yes.
This weekend, next week.
And next week.
If she doesn't run off.
Yes. And so our closing hymn for this morning is number 292 in the blue hymnal, What Wondrous Love Is This?
Pray. Gracious Lord, what wondrous love is this that you have called each one of us into this family of the kingdom of God. Lord, as we depart this day, bless us with your Holy Spirit, understanding and feeling this wondrous love. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. See you soon.